Now, we call the layer of software that grabs data from a data source in the field and brings it into the Pi server, we call that an interface. And the interface is generally bringing data, you know, in this direction, bringing the data into the Pi server, but it also has the capability in some cases to bring data from that Pi interface out to the data source itself. That's an output. So many of the interfaces support that. We typically will run this interface on its own computer, as it's pictured here. And when we do that, we tend to call that computer an interface node, or sometimes we call it a data acquisition node. Actually, if you go back, historically, we've called them API nodes, or we've even called the older VMS versions PiNet nodes, so you might run into those terms in some of our older documentation. Now, I say that we typically will run this on a separate computer, but that's not always necessary. It's not even always a good idea to do it that way. So there's different configurations, really depending on your situation. We'll go over a few of those as we go through. And one of the things the interface does is it can, if it's on a separate node, the interface can buffer data temporarily in the event that the connection to the server is down. So if that server is down, we can buffer data locally. Ends up being a very nice feature. And then, of course, once the system becomes back online, we take that data and we send it back. And that's all automatic. So there's a lot of good features like that in the interface. It can do local buffering. The interface should be writing its own local error logs you can use for troubleshooting. It should automatically start up. So every time the computer restarts, the interface should start. Now, hopefully that'll avoid that, you know, that 3 a.m. phone call that you might get from operations if there's been a power failure and the interface has to, that interface node here has to restart. Yeah, thankfully, with the auto restart, you won't get that 3 a.m. phone call. And then also the interface, any good interface should report by exception. And by reporting by exception, what I mean is if we're going to scan a value, say, once a second, you know, the odds of that value changing significantly each and every time you scan it. You know, on these PLCs, you're looking at temperatures, pressures, voltages, things like that. Well, maybe the voltage is going to change several times in within the course of a second, but all the other things, they tend not to change that quickly. So we typically will want the interface to report only by exception. So, you know, we generate a tremendous amount of data over here, most of which can be considered noise, and we want to bring only those values that really into the interface and then from the interface into the Pi server. We only want to bring those values that are significant. And of course, you're the one that gets to determine what's significant. So you can ignore as much or as little as the data that you might consider noise as you want to. In the videos that come, we're going to be installing a couple of different interfaces. And we're going to discuss, you know, how do we install, how do we configure those interfaces. The first one we're going to configure is something called a ping interface. We're going to start with that because it's the simpler of the two. This data that you see coming in, these are actually measuring the ping rate. That's a ping rate that's being measured in the milliseconds it takes to respond one computer to another. And that's what ping measures. We suggest using the ping interface, which ships with every Pi server, by the way. We suggest using the ping interface to take a look at your other data acquisition nodes, any of the major equipment that you've got in your system, switches, routers, stuff like that, any internal application servers, external websites that you rely on. You know, all those are things that it would be very nice to be able to bring all that data in so that you can see, well, like you can see in this overall trend here, so you can see this trend is showing me that the ping rate is increasing slowly. That's an indication that there's some problem. The latency is increasing over time, so there must be some kind of a bottleneck in the system. Anyway, that's not terribly important right now. The point of this is that we're going to be configuring that interface, and we're going to start with a fairly simple interface, that ping interface. The other interface we're going to install is called the OPC interface. We like to install that one because it's the single most common interface out there. It's very likely that you're, you know, if you're like most of our customers, you probably have got an OPC interface somewhere in your system. Even if you don't have this particular OPC interface, whatever interface you have is going to be very similar to the OPC interface. They're all built off of a standard that we call UNIINT for Universal Interface. So we'll do the OPC interface, and we're going to be using that to gather data from an OPC simulator that we'll encourage you to put on your own machine so you can try that yourself. Now, you have a couple of different ways that you can architect these interfaces. For example, you can put the data source, the interface, and the layer of software, our SDK, API, and buffering service. You can put all of those on the same computer. That's what we mean with this solid line here. This solid line indicates that everything's on one computer. So that would be one computer. This would all be another computer. This would be a third computer here. So anyway, imagine that we've put all of this on one computer. Option A here indicates that everything that we need in order to gather that data and bring it to the Pi server is basically on one machine. So the data source, for example, would be the piece of equipment that's actually generating the data, PLCs or control system, or basically anything that's generating real-time data. Now you can install the interface on that same computer. You can then install our buffering service. That's the one that will buffer data locally if the connection to the server breaks for some reason. So that's all on one machine, and in some cases that's the best architecture. By far, I think the most common architecture and the most robust architecture is not to do it that way, though, but instead to spread the computer on different machines, or the interface on and the data collection on different machines. So it's fairly typical to have the data source on its own dedicated machine, and that may be a Windows machine, a Unix machine, or some proprietary hardware from a PLC manufacturer or a DCS manufacturer of some type. And connected to that, you know, over regular network cables, you would get a computer. This would be a data collection node in which we've installed the Pi interface layer. That's the software, again, that does the collection. And then, in addition, we'll install the SDK or API to do the buffering that will allow us to buffer that data locally. So that would be kind of a traditional data collection node. And, of course, it sends its data onto the Pi server. Now, lastly, if your data source is on a separate machine, you can put the interface and the buffering layer, you can put all of that on the same machine that's running your Pi server. And in that case, if you did have to bring this down for, let's say, to do an upgrade, then the data will just buffer locally on the same computer that's running the Pi server. So that's an option. As I said, for all of these options, what you really want to do is choose the one that's right for you. You know, talk it over with your salesperson, whoever's doing the install. Most typically, though, what we see is people choose this option right here. And this would be, as I mentioned earlier, the traditional data collection node, the interface node, interface and the buffering layer all on a separate computer.